name is Terry Coleman, and I am a diehard Lutheran. I've been Lutheran all my life. I was a lawyer in Texas County for you. I've been a lawyer for about 40 years. I retired, felt compelled to go to the seminary, so I went to Emory and graduated in May of this year. As far as I know, I'm the oldest ever admitted and the oldest graduate. Everybody tells y'all they get older and it doesn't work. That's not true. I had some doubts about that at first, but anyway, since I've graduated, I am now a chaplain at Southern Regional Hospital, and I have a group of about 50 people that meet every Sunday at a retirement meeting, assisted living retirement, and we have a good time every Sunday. I'm sort of used to being with the folks after songs. I make comments about, well, that's my favorite song, or this and that, you know. So I'm sort of used to being just sort of focusing with folks. Can't hardly do all that at church, but we do. But anyway, welcome, and I appreciate you being with me on Sunday. So, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Joined to Christ in the waters of baptism, we are clothed with God's mercy and forgiveness. Let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning your Spirit moved over the waters, and by your word you created the world, calling forth life in which you took the light. Through the waters of his blood, you delivered Noah and his family. Through the sea, you led your people to Israel, slavery free and free. And the river's blood was baptized by John, and the rising of the Holy Spirit. By water and the word, you led us as daughters and sons, making us heirs of your promise. We praise you for the gift of water that sustains life, and above all, we praise you for the gift of new life in Christ, in Jesus Christ. Shower us with your Spirit, and renew our lives with your forgiveness, grace, and love. Our mission here at St. John is we trust God in Christ Jesus, the Spirit of God.
Thank you. congregation of the Israelites complained against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the flesh pots and ate our fill of bread. For you have brought us out into the wilderness to kill this whole assembly of hunger." Then the Lord said to Moses, "I am going to rain bread from heaven for me for you, and each day the people shall go out and gather enough for that day. In that way I will test them whether they will follow my instruction or not." Then Moses said to Aaron, "Say to the whole congregation of the Israelites, 'Draw near to the Lord, for he has heard your complaining.'" And as Aaron spoke to the whole congregation of the Israelites, they looked toward the wilderness, and the glory of the Lord appeared in the cloud. The Lord spoke to Moses and said, "I have heard the complaining of the Israelites. Say to them, 'At twilight you shall eat meat, and in the morning you shall have your fill of bread. Then you shall know that I am the Lord your God.' In the evening, quails came up and covered the camp. And in the morning, there was a layer of dew around the camp. When the layer of dew lifted, there on the surface of the wilderness was a fine, flaky substance, as fine as frost on the ground. When the Israelites saw it, they said to one another, 'What is it?' For they did not know what it was. Moses said to them, 'It is the bread the Lord has given you to eat.'" Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
We will read Psalm 78 responsibly, that whole verse. "So God commanded the clouds above and opened the doors of heaven.
Rain down manna upon the seas, and they gave him the rain from heaven.
So mortals ate the bread of angels. God provided for them food enough.
The Lord caused the east wind to blow in the heavens, and our food out of the south wind.
Raining down flesh upon them like dust, and flying birds like the sand of the seas.
Let it fall in the midst of the camp, and drown about the dwellings."
So the people ate and were filled, for God gave them what they craved. The second reading is found in the fourth chapter of Ephesians. "I, therefore, the prisoner in the Lord, beg you to lead a life worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all, and through all, and in all. But each of us was given grace according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore it is said, 'When he ascended on high, he made captivity itself a captive. He gave gifts to his people.' When it says he ascended, what does it mean but that he had also descended into the lower parts of the earth? He who descended is the same one who ascended far above all the heavens, so that he might fill all things. The gifts he gave were that some would be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until all of us come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to maturity, to the measure of the full stature of Christ. We must no longer be children tossed to and fro and blown about by every wind of doctrine, by people's trickery, by their craftiness and deceitful scheming. But speaking the truth in love, we must grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by every ligament with which it is equipped, as each part is working properly, promotes the body's growth in building itself up in love." Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
themselves got into boats and went to Capernaum, looking for Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly, I tell you, you are looking for me not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For it is on him that God the Father has set his seal." Then they said to him, "What must we do to perform the works of God?" Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." So they said to him, "What sign are you going to give us then, so that we may see it and believe you? What work are you performing?" "Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness. As it was written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat." Then Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, it was not Moses who gave you bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." They said to him, "Sir, give us the bread always." Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
They trusted him more than Moses and God. They were hungry, and God gave them bread. They begged for meat, God gave them quail. And when we see in them is a lack, what we see in them is a lack of faith. Even with all that God had done for them, they wanted to go their own way. If you look at humanity today, you see people have the same problem. No matter how much God does for them, they spend all their time, energy, and life concentrating on other things. Many people think that they can rely on themselves and those around them to solve all their problems, all their wants, all their desires. They concentrate on the pleasures of the world rather than the mercy and grace of God. When we fail on our own, we're like the Israelites. We go back to God. In the Gospel of John today, John tells us that after Jesus had done the miracle, he fed the 5,000. He disappeared, and the people were looking for him. When they couldn't find him, they went to Capernaum. There they found him. And what Jesus told them is, you came after me not because of the miracle, not because of what had happened to them, but rather because of the miracle. And they only looked for him because of that miracle. Jesus told them they should work for food, should not work for the food which perishes, but work for the food that endures for eternity. And they asked Jesus for a sign, like Moses, who gave the Israelites bread and quail. Jesus reminded them it was not Moses who gave them the bread, but it was the Father in heaven. He told them that his Father gave them bread from heaven also. They asked him for that bread, and Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry again." In the gospel lesson, the people asked, "Well, what must we do to perform the works of God?" Jesus said that they must believe in him who he has sent. Paul answered this question. Paul says that there is one faith, one baptism, one God, and Father of all. Paul says that God has given us grace according to the measure of God's gift. Paul says that we need to use these gifts and lead a life worthy of one calling. Paul says that we shall all, with humanity and gentleness, with patience, bear everyone in love, maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. And Paul said that we must no longer be children tossed to and fro and blown about by every wind of doctrine, by people's trickery, by their craftiness and deceitful scheming. We must grow up in every way into him who is the Christ. We cannot be like the Israelites, who were tossed to and fro. We can't be like the people looking for Jesus in the gospel reading. They were looking for another miracle, not for God. I've mentioned before I went to Ethiopia. I learned a great lesson. I've gone on mission to Ethiopia many times. First time I ever went, I knew they needed water. So I took a group of 10 people. We went in Addis Ababa, looked around the whole city, found me a pump from some Chinese manufacturer, put it on a caravan, took it over to the mountains towards the Sudan, down where the church that had invited me, where their base was. So, after going over the hill and down the mountain, I see these huts, tents. They're thatched huts, and they were glowing. We came down the mountain early in the morning, and it was like they were on fire, and I asked the guy, and I said, "What's it? Are they burning or what?" He said, "No, they're cooking breakfast." But it was a glow to it, and as the sun came up, we saw this glow. It was really something to see. When I got down there, we put in a well in front of a church, and the idea, for those who don't know, Ethiopia is one of two Christian churches in Africa. They have many Christians. trying to take the Christians from them. So anyway, I decided what I would do is I'd put 12 next to a church. And so we did the first one. As we did the first one, I had them dig a hole. I bought the pump, put them in the ground. As we were putting it in the ground, I heard a singing. There's about 500 people there. And around the trees came a group of children. One of them had a lamb on the shoulder. And they had palm oil in their hand. And they came down and they encircled the area where I was putting in the pump, singing. And I'm simply going, wow, this is quite something. It was an amazing feeling. We got the well in, and probably the most next amazing feeling was when I saw their faces, when we pumped the last amount of pressure to have water come out, and the glow on the people's faces was just something special. And to give you some idea of how important water is, the government puts pumps or well every 10 miles. So every morning, if you are 10 miles away from a well, or 5 miles away from a well, the women have to take 4 gallons of jug, one in each hand, walk that distance 5 to 10 miles, walk back, then take care of the children. So it consumes most of the women's time getting water. So we decided this was a major, major thing. So I started putting in wells. We ended up putting in about 25. And they serve about 60,000 people who don't have to walk 10 miles to get water. And the women, bless them, they were amazing, amazing what they did. They take care of the water. They take care of the people. I saw elderly people older than me. Women bent over like this with sticks on their back. They walked all morning to get wood to bring back to the camp, to the site. Now these sites, these tents, have no furniture. They have no obviously don't have stove. They have no electric. They have nothing in them. They cook outside on rocks, and they sleep in the tents, and that's all they got. And it amazed me. At first, when I first went there, I felt so sorry that they had so little. But you know what, folks? What I saw in them, their children still played in front of those tents like they had everything in the world. The people, they were appreciative of what they had. When they get up in the morning, they were with God. When they walked all day, they were with God. When they went to bed at night, they were with God. They spend more time with God than most of us. And I thought about that. You know, we only get a certain amount of time on this earth, in this body, and then the rest of the time we're going to be with God somewhere. The point of that is, what do we do in that short time? And I think God wants us to walk with Him, like when He had Adam and Eve. He wanted to be in fellowship with Him. Those people. It's like breathing. You couldn't take God out of it. You can't take it out of it because it's so much a part of it. And I thought maybe they have a blessing that we don't have. You know, in this country we have so many things that detract us from God. We spend so much time away from God on other things. Those people. There is no other thing. And so I think we learned a lesson from it. We went there, at first I went there to think, well, I'll, bring God to them. God's been there a long, long time. You know, Ethiopians were in the Bible. I went to stone churches where they actually took a rock, dug around the rock, and then into the rock and made a church. The most amazing thing that's been there for 1,000 years. God was there a long time before I arrived there. God takes care of those people. And I think they have that relationship. What we can learn from them is we need to be closer. We don't need to let everything around 400 or 500 people. I mean, this is a big thing for them. And I would tell them that when I asked them, I dedicated it to Jesus. And I said, every time you take and drink of this water, I want you to think about God and God's love, who gave you this. I didn't give you this. God gave you this. And so it's sort of like Jesus was talking in our gospel. We forget who God is, and we forget who we are. God made us all, and from Him we came, and from Him we're going back. God, that is what we were made to do. And so, since that is true, I think we need a life, as Paul said, a life that is dedicated to Him. We in our country are so spoiled. We are so, so, so blessed. But in our blessing and in our being spoiled, we have lost a lot of that relationship that people could have with God, should have with God. The thing that I will always live with is every time I turn on a water spigot, I think about the water leaving me. Because it is two things, I think. One, God, hopefully God will bless them with what little we can do. And God will keep them in his hand arms. And I hope that we too can come back to where we once were. You know, when I first started, I did this for about 10 years. And unfortunately, I can't go now because of COVID and some other things. When I first started, Ethiopia Church, the church of Ethiopia, had about 6 million people. When I left Ethiopia, it had 16 million people. And I tell my folks over at Amazing Grace that, you know, these people who think that we're going to, every person in heaven is going to be like us, there's going to be an awful lot of Africans and other people in heaven. We can learn from them, and we can learn from this lesson for today that we can't just be well about, and one day we believe this, and one day we believe that. You can't be blown around like that by what happens to you, what we have, or what people say or do. We can't do that. We gotta be solid in what we believe, and we need to be solid in our relationship to God. And if we do that, we'll be ready for the day when we too can go be with Jesus. Remember the water. Remember the people of Ethiopia who have a relationship that is quite phenomenal. It's an amazing lesson that I learned. I share it with you. We should be more like that. We let so many things separate us. And I think that is not pleasing to God. It's in our gospel lesson. See, Paul said, that is not what we are to. So let's think about it. And like I said, remember the water. So. call your church to be the body of Christ. Awaken all the baptized to the gifts you provide for carrying out the work of the ministry. Where the church is divided, knit us together and restore the unity of faith. Bless the ministry of Augustine Lutheran School, Guatemala, and Judge St. Joe Thomas Bavaria. We pray for Grace Mission and Chez Mori Orphanage Haiti. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You summon leaders to respond to the needs of your people. Install those who govern with patience. When confronted with agreements and perseverance, and seeking what promotes the well-being of the community. We pray for those who serve in the military, especially and support. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We draw near to those who cry out for help. Feed those who are hungry. Reassure those who are despairing, especially Kathleen, Charlie, William, Bob, Susan and David, Maureen, April, Andy, June, John, Sarah, Catherine, Terry, Bill, Elizabeth, Jade, Marcus. Rain down the true bread from heaven that gives life to the world. Hear us, O God.
Mercy is great.
Bless those who are celebrating birthdays. Walt, Forrest, Janet, Jared, those celebrating baptism, Cheryl, Allie, hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We lift up all others we name in our hearts for honor. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We lift our prayers to Let us pray. Praise and thanks to you, Holy God, for by your word you made all things. You spoke light into darkness, called forth beauty from chaos, and brought life into being. For your word of life, O God,
we give thanks and praise.
By your word, you called your people Israel to tell your wonderful gift, freedom from captivity, water on the desert journey, a path by home from exile, wisdom for life, for your word of life, O God.
We give thanks and praise.
Through Jesus, your word made flesh, you speak to us and call to witness forgiveness through the cross, life to those entombed by death, the way of your self-giving love. For your word of life, O God, we give you thanks
and praise.
Send your spirit of truth, O God, rekindle your gifts within us, renew our faith, increase our hope, and deepen our love for the sake of the world in need. Faithful to your word, O God, draw near to all who call on you, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory forever.
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory.
Bible and pray for us while we prepare for this trip and also
then missionary work around the world, now work with elderly people that people have forgotten. And I say all that to say, maybe of this on me, simply there are people in this world who need emotional help, physical help, that they need you. They need God's people to work for them. And you're never too old. Never. And anybody ever tell you're too old to do anything? They told me I was too old to go to the seminary. Well, they're wrong about that, but I went my grade. Point is, there are people in need. They need you. And I encourage you to use your life as best you can to take care of God's kingdom, take care of God's purpose. He will bless you for eternity. Thank you. Now, blessing of God, provide for us, feed us. Blessing of God, provide for us, feed us, and journeys with us. Be upon you now and forever.
Amen.
We are one in God.
And also with you.